We're live.
The devil went down to Georgia. He was looking for a soul to steal. He was in a bind because he was way behind and he was willing to make a deal. When he came across this young man sewing on the fiddle and playing it hot, and the devil jumped up on a heap of dumps and said, "Boy, let me tell you what. I guess you didn't know it, but I'm a fiddle player too. And if you'd care to take a dare, I'll make a bet with you. Now you play pretty good fiddle, boy, but give the devil his due. I bet a fiddle of gold against your soul, because I think I'm better than you." The boy said, "My name..."
You turn it down, Matt Forbes.
Sorry, Matt.
Mike Zeno, how are we doing, buddy?
We're doing great. We had a little fun there because, look at, shout out right away. Who are we going to shout out right away?
We are going to shout out our number one fan, Alex Muna, who said he's watched, he remembers episode one. Do you remember episode one? He got us this amazing belt buckle in Texas. And since I have no belt on my robe, I thought I would brandish it right there. Even matches.
I love it.
Now that I think about it, I think he planned the colors, the black and the red and the gold.
He color coordinated us.
He did.
So, wait a minute.
So
let's back up, because somebody might be brand new tonight and go, "Wait a minute. The devil down in Georgia, a couple guys in funny robes and some belt buckles. What's going on here?" I thought I was in a land investing group.
That's exactly right. So we are the Land Geek guys. And almost a year ago, we decided we should have a weekly nighttime show where we talk land investing and have a nightcap.
Just a small beverage, not required. You can come here drinking coffee, tea, or milk. It's all the same. It's all here to kind of come together and talk about land investing. And, you know, it's just awesome. You know, and we're coming off a power weekend, really. We were just in Texas at the first boot camp of 2019. How was that, Scott, huh?
You know, what a great way to start the year in this community. It was a phenomenal experience. It was a lot of fun. It's always a lot of fun connecting with people.
Yes.
It's always a lot of fun meeting new people in the community and seeing the excitement in their eyes and hearing the excitement in their voices. And then we always, no matter where you are in your journey, you walk away with tidbits that help you in your business.
Yeah, so true. So true. It was just a great gathering. You know, I'll tell you what really is incredible is when we do a session called Grill the Geeks, and we have people that are, you know, at different levels of success in the business tell their story, right? And that is so empowering. It is so awesome because you see people that are literally changing their lives inside of one year.
Yeah, that's exactly right. To hear from multiple people, 5-6 people standing up front, where they were a year ago and where they are now. And it's all a result of massive action. It's a result, I would say it has to be a result of this community and the coaching in this community, because I think, you know, people are taking off much more quickly than they did 3 years ago. And it's because of our coaching. Our coaching is getting better all the time. Flight school is getting better all the time.
Flight school makes coaching better. It makes people more coachable, if that's a correct way to say it. But it gives them such a fundamental understanding of the business. Scott Todd's gets you to move your feet, right? He says it all the time. This is about moving your feet so you start getting results. If you can get results in this business, proof of concept, we always say it again and again, it's huge. And then you can truly begin to take massive action. If you believe in it, you feel the power of it, you're not going to hesitate when your coach tells you to take extremely massive action. And when people do that, the results are insane.
They really are insane. And, you know, it's a testament to this community that people are doing so well. You know, they get into this and sometimes, you know, after starting, I think we had somebody last month, Mike, they, you know, in flight school, they bought a property for like $2,000. They sold it for $8,500.
Yeah.
I mean, That's huge. That's quick results. It's proof of concept right out of the gate. And, you know, we have overwhelming evidence now that flight school works, you know.
Oh, yeah.
People, if you follow the recipe, if you execute, overwhelming success.
Absolutely true. And another thing I thought was interesting is that, you know, a couple people were like, geez, we thought we were going to come here and it was going to be like hundreds of people and, you know, we're going to be back at some auditorium. And I don't think they truly recognize until you go there how small of a niche that we're in, number one, and then how close-knit. We're a small community. We keep these things small. We don't blow these things out, right? We keep them really intimate so everybody can kind of work together and just have a really good, you know, it's a great community, good sense of the connection that comes with it. And it really, it's awesome. So I think that's important, right, to realize. I mean, I salute the people that come that have, some people, they've come, they get the toolkit and they don't really know anything about it other than maybe they see our podcast, they see a couple guys in red robes talking about land investing, but they don't really know, you know, like really what it's going to be like. And they take their time and they spend their money and they travel down there and they go to this and then they're blown away because they're like, whoa, this is much better than I anticipated. I thought it was going to be some just huge convention. And it's really, it's a close-knit group of people and their reward is tenfold. No, that's no hyperbole, right? Their reward is tenfold.
Ooh, good word at 10:30 at night. Hyperbole. I'm impressed. Yes, I mean, that was a very common theme this weekend, which I've heard in the past, but never as much as this weekend, about the strength of our community and the quality people we have in our community and the transparency that people are willing to give forth with information and motivational tips, tech tips. I mean, everything. So I kept hearing that from people we were talking to. This is a great community. I think you had heard from somebody that, you know, he found out that there were returnees. I mean, how many returnees do we have? We have people that have been back 2, 3, 6, 7, 8 times.
Yeah.
That's really a testament as well to the program and the community. And that person was blown away, weren't they?
Absolutely. And it's a true testament to, you know, not only to the flight school and Mark putting this together, but also to, you know, Tate, Eric, Mimi, the coaches that really provide the content over that weekend in that VIP room, which is a room for people that have been to multiple boot camps. They're in coaching and they come back because they get taken to a deeper level. And, you know, it's, again, we have great people that we're surrounded by a great community and a great group of people that kind of head that community. Right. And we're, you know, I know you and I, we say it all the time. We're very blessed and excited to be surrounded by those kind of people because it ups our game, right? It ups all of our game.
It really does up our game. And that is something that I would never have guessed when I got into this 3.5 years ago, or it's maybe something that I underestimated. I believed in the business model. I believed that it could provide financial security.
Right.
I believed because I saw that people were quitting their job after a short period of time. I believed and I learned that this business model provides you with more time for your family members, but I completely underestimated, and it's really overwhelming to me at times in a very good way, how this community has helped me become a better person, a better business person. And you know, it's really amazing because that's an investment right there also that I was not expecting any return on, honestly.
Right. No, it's awesome. And you're right. We always feel the benefits. We traveled to see some family in Florida from the boot camp, and some of you may have seen in the Facebook page. You know, I do it kind of jokingly, but it's just awesome. I'm riding a, I don't even know what kind of bike. I don't think quadricycle is the right word.
Quattro.
Right. And then my sales agent boxes me, hey, we just sold the property. I'm setting up the agreement right now. Blah, blah, blah. It's like, it's just incredible. And I just feel really blessed that I came across a model like this that can work that way, right? That can work when we're not. And that is like the essence of this, right? Is that we scale our time and we're able to get bigger results with less effort, right? We put it's an, I always say land investing is a team sport. You need eight players for an eight team, and you put them in place, and you take the action and you connect the dots, and then you let them do their job and things happen.
Yeah, for sure. Well, that's awesome, dude. Let's say hi to some people. We got a few people watching.
Do we?
Larry Overstreet. It was great to see you this last weekend. He traveled down to boot camp in the RV. He's living in the RV. Kevin Levy's here. Kevin, it was
Kevin's awesome. Here? All right. Larry.
Stephen Burke.
Have you?
What's that?
Burke. I was just saying, I'm echoing you. I'm just saying hi to everybody. Sorry.
Oh, no. Stephen Burke, we're excited for you. You're starting flight school soon. Jeremiah McCam, always nice to see you. Matthew Forbes, sitting in the waiting room.
We should
go flying. Michaela Sorsny is watching. John Michael McLeod is watching. Jackie Van Sirksum is watching. Some of these, Jackie's starting flight school soon. Sergio's watching. Sergio is a flight school grad. He was at boot camp this weekend. And he did a deal, I think, the day after boot camp.
This is awesome. You know, you remind me of right now when we used to watch that show. You know, what was it? And she'd say, I see Matt and I see Scott. What was that show when we were all kids? Am I dating myself?
You might be. Is that the Bozo the Clown?
No, no. Matt Forbes.
Oh, Mr. Rogers?
No, not Mr. Rogers. Can we bring him in? I think we should get perspective from somebody else. We keep talking about Boone. Let's bring somebody else in for a fresh perspective.
Matt Forbes is yelling at me right now because I missed a couple people. I wasn't trying to miss people, Matt Forbes. Bring him in. Don't be mad at me. Baron and Aaron might be here, but I just didn't see him in the list.
So I'm going to promote to a panelist, Matt, the no nickname Forbes.
The no nickname.
Here he comes. So Matt, the no nickname Forbes.
So you think Matt is going to provide you the name of this obscure TV yes. show when you yes. were a child?
Help me out.
When you were a child.
If I'm not the one, somebody in the audience is gonna bring it up. It was when, Cal Burnett show. Okay, it was the Cal Burnett show. It was when at the end she would have her little thing. She, I see Matt, I see Scott, I see Mike. I was just reminding me when you did that, Scott.
Hold on. Let me go call my mom. Maybe she'll give us the answer.
Oh.
You and your shows, you and your childhood shows, we've already talked about Sha Na Na on this show.
That was a group. Yeah. No, who doesn't know Sha Na Na?
He's ready to defend, right? I love it.
Oh, my gosh. Paul Bilotti's here. He said Wonderama? Wonderama? Does that sound right?
I don't know if it's Carol Burnett or Wonder Hour. I just remember if someone were to say it, I would know it. Maybe it was the Carol Burnett. No, it wasn't the Carol Burnett. It was
Larry Overstreet says Romper Room.
It was Romper Room.
Yeah. Larry. No, it wasn't.
Yes, it was. Larry Overstreet for the win. Larry Overstreet for the win. That was Romper Room.
From the RV in Texas, ladies and gentlemen.
For the win. Romper Room. Jeffrey Yurick, Romper Room. We've got two. Paul Bilotti, Romper Room. See, yeah.
you are dating yourself, my friend.
Yeah, I gotta say something just to Paul. Sorry, Paul was in my neck of the woods the other day, but I couldn't get together with him. I felt bad. So, Paul, we'll talk soon. No worries.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah,
Matt's nickname. Oh, this is from Jackie. This is a good one. No, Matt's nickname should be Whataburger Matt.
So this Whataburger Matt.
So this is what boot camp is really all about.
Yes, tell us.
Hanging out with people like Jackie and her husband, Rick, who had never been to a boot camp. And Jackie is a lot like me, super skeptical, like, no way this works, yada, yada, yada. Rick is like more positive. And we just started hanging out. I had plans to go out to dinner with like the titans of coaching, right? You know, Dave Dennison and you know, all these guys are like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10K, you know, in passive a month. And then I was like, you know what? We're going to go out, forget it. We'll go out with Jackie and her wife and a bunch of others that I had met that day. We all went out to Whataburger and it was fun. So that's, you know, people you meet are great.
That's awesome. It was good. Yeah, shout out to Rick and Jackie. They're my people. Jackie grew up in South Dakota, three hours north of where I grew up. And Rick grew up just a little ways away from my wife, Erin, in Western Minnesota. So we clicked like this.
Matt Forbes is like my people. He's from the Northeast. Yeah, quick click. Yep.
Yeah, I'm from New England. I hate people. I don't like talking. You
know? And you sound exactly like Zeno.
Yeah, that part is kind of odd. People are just think he's weird, and I'm normal. I think.
So, Matt, tell us your perspective on the boot. We're I've been to several now, without giving away the VIP room content or anything like that, but just what's the experience of, you know, how was it for you?
It was really good. So I went to Vegas last year just to like bring my wife, right? Like little by little, as you guys know, I had to get Bosman to like talk to her just to get her to understand. Right. And then once she went to Vegas and met, you know, Scott and Mark and you guys, she was like, okay, this is kind of real. I get it. And then we both went to Orlando, and I had signed up for coaching like the day before. Right. So I'm like, Mark, here's the deal. I'll sign up for coaching, but you got to put me in the VIP room. Not that I had any idea what the VIP room was. I just thought it was cool. So I was like, well, if we're going to sign up anyways, for sure, I'm going to be in that room. So we did that and totally overwhelmed when we were there the first time, because I didn't really have any coaching experience. And we were just sort of merrily going along our business. But you guys got me to sell my first two or three properties, which was great. So this time I've been with Tate for 3 months. And sold a bunch of properties on terms, and like, hey, I'm starting to really get the business and it's working. So this right. time was really, really different. My wife wasn't there and threatened my marriage if I didn't come back with a note. So I was like very, very quiet. Even Mimi Schmidt was like, hey, you're not really talking that much. And I'm like, but look at all my notes. Look what a good job I did. Like I'm in college again. So it was great. Like it was what she said. You guys don't say enough, and you should, which is you get exactly what you need when you go to boot camp, because you have all these mental blocks and they're sitting right in front of you and you can see right. them. And those are taken care of. Whatever it is, it's kind of irrelevant. Those are taken care of either in the coaching pieces or just networking with everybody else. And then everything else flies over your head. And then yes. you come back 13 weeks later and you have a new problem and that gets worked out. And everything else goes over your head. And she's like, this is why this I've been here 11 times or 10 times or I don't know, 87 times. I have no idea. But it was like, that's what she said to me at 9:15 on Friday morning. And I'm like, okay, this is good. And Scott Todd does kind of a presentation about his business. And I won't really get into it. But I saw that same presentation 3 months ago. And was like, wow, Scott Todd's the man. Look at that. I kind of saw a little bit of it in flight school. But this time, it's exactly what I needed. And I'm like, oh my God, you're an evil genius and I have to go do that. So it's, you get what you need, I think is the yes. way. Like Mark says, like, you always get a nugget. I don't think it's a nugget. I think we have to amend that statement from him. You get the nugget, the one nugget you need.
And
you
have 2 dozen of
them. Yeah, that's the thing to understand about bootcamp. And that's why I love going. And a lot of people give me their drink tickets, which was awesome. if you give me a drink ticket next time, I'll give you a hug. Hug the big guy.
Why do you get the drink ticket?
I'm taller than you.
Oh, I was just gonna say you're gonna bring up the size thing.
Yeah.
I'm bigger, so I need more drinks.
If that right? gets me drink tickets, fine. No worries. Whatever it takes to get the free booze. So yeah.
Oh my gosh. Aaron Williams thinks your nickname should be Matt Make It a Double Forbes.
Wow.
Which wow. kind of goes hand in hand with what I've seen so far.
Well, you know, it was fun to get to know Berlin. I didn't really talk to him the last boot camp because he's like, you know, he's on like the round table and, you know, he's too cool. But he's awesome. We hang out a lot, especially at the bar. And yeah, I usually throw down 2 drink tickets at a time. Feel pretty good about that.
Nice. We got a few other watchers. Jeremy Robert Lee is watching. Welcome. John Paul, JP Moses just tuned in, I think, for his first time. So, JP, welcome to the Meandering Martini, guys.
Me, that's us.
Right, Zainal?
We drink that.
So, anyway, yeah, I put in the comments there, give us your boot camp takeaways. If anybody was at boot camp this weekend, please type out a sentence or two about your experience. Post any questions in the group about land investing in general, about the Land Geek programs.
I want to hear Jackie's experience with bootcamp because she had to put up with me for a little while. So I would like to hear something out of her since I know she's watching. And she called me Whataburger, Matt. Like I eat a lot.
I like that. I like that nickname. Right. So I think there's another thing we need to talk about while people are coming up with their takeaways from bootcamp. And that is...
And we just had the... highest viewers ever, 27. right now.
Nice. 27,000. 27,000,
yes.
Basically, we're just ahead of the U.S.
Whoever just signed off, you two, come back. That's at 25. Don't do that. Mm-hmm. Come back.
That was my wife.
Because we're about to do something that you're going to want to see.
Oh, I like it.
Oh,
so but let me give an intro.
Okay, give an intro.
Okay, so we do need to talk about the bootcamp magic, and Mark has spoken about this for a really long time. 3 years ago, when I went to bootcamp, Aaron and I experienced the bootcamp magic. We sold the property at bootcamp. Multiple people did it this last weekend. Somebody does it all the time. Sergio Flores sold one, I think, the day bootcamp ended, or maybe the day after. Brent Bowers, his dad sold one the day after. John Burnett, I think, sold two this last weekend. I'm sure there are others we don't know about. But I think there's a – what's so funny, Matt Forbes? I think
I'm interrupting your story. John Burnett is in the hallway of the hotel, right? And there's a bunch of us, and now, like, we're all buddies, right? We've hung out for the weekend. Yeah. So I'm such a nice guy. I'm sitting there and I'm like, all right, everybody yell scam on three. Because you can hear him in the background being like, oh, we have a 90-day guarantee and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like,
oh, no.
Scam! Scam! Sorry.
Well, that's not very nice at all. How would you feel, Matt Forbes, if somebody did that to you?
Makes him work through a difficult time. Makes him better, the guy.
Yeah, I'm not worried. Handsome Rob, who John Burnett, by the way, his new name is Handsome Rob. So stop calling him John Burnett. And he took it like a champ. He did great. So
yeah, that's awesome. So he had success, and you know that success after boot camp, I believe, carries through the week, and people go home and they experience wins, whether it's getting their first list, sending out their first mailing. Logan and Alyssa Swanson, by the way, they attended boot camp last week. And on the day that boot camp started, they dropped a bunch of mailers in the mailbox on the way to boot camp. That's a great way to start boot camp. But people coming home from boot camp, they experience wins, right? They get things in the mail, right?
Right.
Mike Zano?
Right. Let's do this.
Let's do what?
I'm having this thing now where I can actually look at people's handwriting, and before I open it, kind of get a feel if it's going to be a good or bad one.
Oh, well, hold it up, and let's hold you accountable to this so that we can see it. And then you tell us, is it a deal or do they hate you? Is this deal or no deal? Is that like Land Geek style?
So here's the thing.
This is going to be – so what happened is we had Scott print out some. His wife printed them out, some that he – you know, sometimes they email them to you. So his wife printed them out. So he doesn't know what they are. She knows what they are, but she folded them. So it would be kind of a fair. It's me undoing them, and Scott.
A couple emails, a couple faxes. For those that are watching for the first time. Okay, let's give them a little background on this, Mike.
Yes.
So for a long time, Mark Podolsky would go on Facebook Live, or he'd create a video where he walked to the mailbox. He walked to the mailbox. He opened the mailbox up, and he opened the mail with his viewers on Coffee Talk or whatever. So this is our little take on Coffee Talk. It's Nightcap Talk, and we're opening purchase agreements that were sent back to us by mail or email or fax.
You know what?
Don't show that return address. That's probably illegal.
I'm not showing it, but I'm saying if someone puts it on there, they're probably old, and if they're old, probably accept an offer.
Yeah, those return address stickers are gold right there.
I feel like this is like the Johnny Carson, you know, like back in the 80s. And he was like, all right, what is it? It's like, it's an accepted offer. And he'll like go into it.
We're not going to hand out our area. It's not going to be that simple. You guys want to find us, you're going to come looking for us.
But here's the thing. Zano and I are having a little friendly competition, actually.
Ooh.
There is an area that we're mailing to.
Together?
Come find it.
Wait. Mom and Dad together? Oh.
Well, It's me versus him. We're not got a little contest going on here. So
come find us.
Zano, I got four offers. I got four offers.
So I told you I got four in the mail when I got back. So you went and had Baron print off the four most recent ones that you hadn't looked at. And so Scott has no idea whether they're accepted, countered, or go screw type ones, you know?
And I promise you, that I do not know what's in these envelopes.
All right, so who's going first then?
You go first.
Back and forth. Let's go. Open one up.
Oh, right away it says mail to please. Okay, I like this. Well, there's my theory blown out of the water. I had a nice return sticker. I figured, hey, this is my offer price on this one was just between $350 and the count was $2,000. So there goes my theory about the sticker. If anybody knows me, they know this is not over. This is not over.
It's true.
It's not over.
Somebody just needs an education. And we're going to get
here's my first one from Mr. Gelminas.
There we go.
Say names now? I couldn't show my return envelope, but you can say names?
I mean, so I offered for this 1 acre, I offered for this parcel $377, and he countered at $400. That's a win.
We have a win. There we go.
One to nothing.
All right.
Next.
I like this game. This is good.
This is kind of fun, isn't it?
This is good. We can make this into
I hope we get a shove it quote live.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
All right. Okay. This is an offer of $327, and it is completely accepted.
Oh. Yes, no counter?
No counter.
All right.
No counter.
One each, and Zeno has the low, which is the tiebreaker.
The lead on this one.
Yeah.
All right, it's 1-1.
We're going the same area. He would still have to have a lower offer to win this one if he got accepted.
All right. So another 1 acre parcel here. I got Mr. Michael T. And let's see, I offered $377, and he countered at $500.
Win.
Still a win. Yeah, that counts.
Still a win.
That's a win, but I got no counter, Matt. It's 1-1.
2-2.
Matt, no counter. It's got to be 1-1.
Hold on. It's 2-1, but if it's a tie, you win because you have the low.
Okay. Right?
I got low accepted.
Right. I buy it. Okay, next one.
Yeah.
I like it here.
You're the worst person who's ever mailed me. Mail me again, and I'll kill you.
Let's see what we got here.
Anticipation is killing me. Devin Clark week. Here we go. I can see it coming. Here we go. Counter to $2,000.
But wait a minute. I didn't know. This is another area I guess my team mailed. I didn't know about it. Okay. So what did I offer? Oh, I offered, this is a larger property, and every so often I do this, I venture out, I like these ones. It's like this is around a $5,000 offer, and the counter was $25,000. So we're going to go with it. Still workable, still potential. Let's not count me out, Matt, but it's probably not good.
If you want offers like that, here you go. You can have all these.
Okay.
All right. Come in. If you make the money, give me half.
All right.
All right.
That's all right. You got to branch out every now and then.
Or else it's going to stay. It's 2-1 still, right?
Yeah, 2-1.
After this, Mike, let's talk about our different types of land too, because I mean that's something to talk about. All right, here, number three. Mr. JH, I offered $349, and he countered at $500. Not bad.
That's going to be doable because you'll close them at $4.
I think it's doable. We'll close them at $4.
Yeah. And what are you going to sell that property for?
So, I mean, the comps are 15 to 1900 cash.
Right.
But these properties are great $99 down properties, right? Yeah. Why are you shaking your head, Zeno?
Because I just opened my next one.
Uh-oh. How is it?
It's a win!
What, not a good one?
So, every so often I mail some bigger areas because, you know, you can take this business any way you want. So, the bread and butter is between a couple hundred and a couple thousand, right? We always talk about that. Sure. But, you know, once you get some capital built, you can buy a property for $5. If it takes a little longer to sell, you get a nice cash fall, right? So, I go for those. I don't discriminate. And they thought that maybe it would be worth $30,000.
Oh.
Oh, tough.
It's all right. Hey, you know what?
It happens.
In this business, we experiment a little bit.
I'm mad about that. I'm mad about losing this game.
Oh, well, you're mad about losing the game? Well, you're about to lose more, my friend, because
the land doesn't matter. That's irrelevant.
Well, that's a numbers game, Matt. That's just
that part's irrelevant. For Mr. Souza, I offered him 349 and he countered me at 500. So, although I did get four counter offers, they're all within reason.
Dana, and
we're good to go.
Have a cocktail, bro. Have a cocktail, brother. You're going to be okay.
But you know what?
Let's have a refill.
I celebrate you and your victory.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Bosman for mailing people out and getting four accepted offers while doing work at boot camp. I don't know what you do. Yeah.
You don't know what I do. Yes.
I'm not really sure what it is you do here, Bob.
And Mike for being a very good competitor and very happy to allow Scott to be the winner.
That was very nice of you, Mike.
I would agree. Good job, Bosman.
Good sportsmanship award. Does Mike get that?
There you go. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. I'll tell you, I got one angry phone call.
Nice.
And the woman said, I sent back the letter and I called you and you didn't call me back this morning. And I want you to call me back so that you can buy my land. And I got an offer accepted in my new county that I mailed right before boot camp. So I'm like super pumped.
Good work, dude.
Yeah.
It's awesome. It's happening.
I know.
It is a happening.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, Mike, that was fun. We should do that.
It's not Churchill. Is he making a joke? Is that the one they use at boot camp? What example? What property?
That's the bomb county.
That's why John McLeod saying that. Churchill.
Yeah, that's where a lot of the military testing takes place.
Oh, yeah.
So you want to stay out of Churchill County, Nevada.
That's right. They talk about that all the time.
Well, that was fun.
Good.
That was fun, wasn't it?
So why don't you guys, since you're, you know, good at this and, you know, have real jobs, why don't you guys talk about not the area, but all right. So, you know, how many mailers did you send out and you know, what should you be getting these things on terms for?
Yeah.
Right? How about a little love for the people at home who don't really know what it is you're talking about?
Right. So this is a numbers game, right? And we talk about in flight school, Scott sets the bar basically 20 a day, 100 a week, you know, the reason is, in the beginning, although this is a team sport, you need to learn how to do every aspect of it yourself, right? So if you were to lay down a larger number per week, you could cause a little mental angst, a little overload because you haven't developed a system to handle it yet, right? And it just can get, you know, a little bit too quick for you. So you build this in a micro, as I always say, and blow it up in the macro. But once you have a system in place, right? Once you have people that can handle your intake, like, so these people, I'm not contacting them back. That doesn't fall upon me anymore. I have someone that takes care of that, right? I don't do the due diligence anymore. I don't do the closing, the marketing, or the sales. So I can actually send out volumes, right? So I'll send out myself, and we were talking this, I think, in the VIP room. Maybe you were at the table, Matt. When Mark was there, we were talking about, I was saying that, I don't know if you were at that table at that time, but I'll send out a couple thousand at a time, you know. Scott Todd will recommend rather to stay solid with so many per week, but you know, there's ways that you can work this business when you know your model and you know the way the ebbs and the flows, right? I call mine the popcorn method. What it means is when you put something in the microwave and you hear the popping and then eventually it slows down. Well, if you know your business, you have your finger on the pulse of your business, if your deals are starting to slow down, right? And to a certain point, you know it's time to hurry up and instead of taking a bag of popcorn out, but you got to get more. So I know when it gets to a certain point, just because of the historical results that I have, that I'll send out another couple thousand. So that's how I do it. And it's fun. And I like it. So I always have things coming my way. Always.
Yeah, and I try to stay consistent. I'll try to have a mailing Monday where I send out 250, 300 offers. It's Mike.
Mailing Monday. I like that.
Mike, where's your sign? It's all about deal flow, right?
Oh, baby.
It's all about deal flow.
It's all about deal flow. And the only way you deal flow is by consistently mailing. And if you keep those mailers consistent, you will get deal flow and you will get deals. Right. So Matt, back to your original question. So these lots, you know, that I'm hoping to purchase around, I mean, ideally 350, maybe $400. You know, the cash counts are about $1,500. You know, you could do.
How quick can you have your money out on those, Scott, if you did terms?
Good question.
I mean, you could do 99 down, 75 a month for 36 months and get your money out in 4 or 5 months. So, you know, somewhere around there, 99 down, 75 a month, 99 down, 99 a month. You could mix it up a little bit, 87 down, 87 a month, somewhere around there. Over the course of 30 months to 3 years on these lots. Nice. And, you know, as you can see, you can find areas where there's good volume and, you know, there's areas out there where you can do multiple deals like that. And it may not sound like a lot, but you do 5, 10, 15, 20 of them, man, that really moves the needle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you really got to listen to the market, right? You can't, and this is interesting because when we do these exercises at boot camp and people do these, you know, we do this kind of mock deals and people are like, okay, well, I'm going to get 2,000 down and this and that. And, you know, you do what you kind of like work it out so it mathematically makes sense, but it may not make sense for the market, right? What we want isn't what we get. We get what the market will pay, right? And, you know, we had two properties that, you know, were in an inventory a little longer than I wanted. So we readjust the pricing and they both sold within a week after that, right? So it's just, you have to listen to the market, right? You have to pay it. You can't just get what you want. Yeah, sometimes we do actually get thousands of dollars down on a property. It does actually happen. And but you can't count on that, right? It's just sometimes people come to the table with that kind of money. But you have to, you can't just, you know, basically you want to make these things irresistible, right? And when you make them, as long as you make them irresistible and you get your money out within that 10-month period, maybe 12 months if you want to stretch all of it, then you're doing the right thing. And you can do these over and over again.
Awesome.
All right, I thought I lost you there. All right, well, we got any segments?
No, you didn't lose me.
We've been cranking this out.
I think we should do a couple of these. You ready?
All right, let's see it.
The Facebook quote of the week.
Okay, I'll take it.
What are you laughing at?
I know which one he was hoping for.
Huh?
I know which one he was hoping for.
Oh, I know. I know. I know. I know. Well, you know, the show's still still going on here, so we'll see what happens. But we got a couple of quotes of the week here. First one is from Sergio Flores. Says, I think this was on Monday. Still, and he went to boot camp this last weekend. So still buzzing with excitement after a great weekend at boot camp. Definitely benefited from the wealth of information presented and all the networking with the community. And we rode that boot camp magic wave as we sold two properties over the weekend. Thanks, Mark, all the coaches, geeks, and the community in general for being so open and forthcoming with all of your tips and tricks.
So awesome.
That's awesome, Sergio.
Yeah.
Phenomenal. Great work. Before we go on to the next quote of the week, we got a question from Stephen Burke. If we get a lot that's not on a dirt road, how do you check access? Is there a creative way to market easements? That's an interesting.
Oh, question. So it's going to be a landlocked parcel then.
Right.
No.
So is he saying that maybe it's platted out? I think what it sounds like he's saying it's platted out, but no one's developed the road yet. It's almost
maybe solid. there's a paper road.
Sometimes you look at these, you know, you look at these platted out properties and they're there. The road is there. So there's legal access, right? But it's not actually graded, scraped, bladed, see, you know, you can't see it on a overhead map. I think that's what he's referring to. If the way that sounds, not on a dirt road. How do you check access method? Is there a great way to market?
Well, you would check access, Stephen, with the county. Look at plat maps to see if there is a paper road there.
Sometimes
on paper road. What's that?
Sometimes it actually calls out on the deed too.
Right, calls out on the deed. So. So that would be the first part of your question there. Is there a creative way to market easements? Any ideas on that one, Michael?
To market easements? Well, I don't know if I'd market the easement. I'm saying if there's an easement that's there, then there's access, right? I always tell people when I'm selling property or our team is selling it, that if they have any questions you know, about what exactly we're going to do with the property, or, you know, contact the county, do your due diligence. We don't want to have someone come back and say that, you know, you said this, you said that. But I think it brings up a bigger point here. You know, I think it's really important and really a great idea when you mail an area that you mail an area that you know already. Like, I mail areas that I know the access is there. I know the roads are all platted out. So, you know, if you get a list, right, say you get this huge county list and you batch them out, which is the best way to do it, right? You take out certain segments, you price them all at once. Look at that. Most of the sites we work in have you are user-friendly by the county, right? So they have these clickable GIS systems. You can look at them. Have mail areas that have platted out subdivisions that have access. So just start with the win. Ooh, that's a new
one. Start with the win.
Wow.
Start with the every week there's something. Last week it was 2 weeks ago, it was start halfway finished. Remember that one, Matt Forbes? My little helicopter going up.
How about win before you start? Start with the win. Is that better, Matt?
Start with the win. I like that. But I really like start halfway.
Start with the win. I might start using in my corporate life. That's how good that is. Oh. Have a good script. Ooh. Start with the win.
Let me just get that website from GoDaddy. As I do every week when I do this, I buy the website. Hold on.
Startwiththewin.com.
Somebody else is probably typing right now. If you're out there watching, don't type faster than me. I'm going for it.
All right. I'm going to do another Facebook quote of the week. You tell me if that is available. I'm thinking that is not available. Next quote of the week is from our very own Matt Forbes.
Oh, no. Huh? No.
Have you ever been featured on the quote of the week?
No, I don't think I like that. I'm not sure I'm comfortable with this.
Too bad. The best part of my plane trip home from boot camp yesterday was booking plane tickets for Scottsdale in April.
Yep.
Lots to get done in the next 15 weeks.
Yep. There's nothing like booking a JetBlue ticket on a Southwest flight. You know, it makes it really fun. It's a good thing.
Is that so?
It's a funny thing. It's like, I don't even know. We don't even have like a hotel, right? You can't even sign up, I don't think, because I don't think registration's open. So I was like, to my wife, like, she's like, well, where are we staying? And I'm like, that part's irrelevant. She goes, are we going to be moving that weekend? Our house, from one house to the house we're building? I'm like, yeah, not that weekend.
Not that weekend. No, it's not weekend. We put moving on hold.
Yeah, I was like, this is more important than moving my house. So, yep, we're doing awesome. It. We'll be there.
Mike, was it available?
Yeah, I'm actually finalizing the purchase right now.
Startwiththewin.com?
Yeah, I got it.
How many do you own now? See, here's the thing with domain names.
Startwiththewin.com is available. It's only
you may own a lot of domain names, but would you do something with them?
Oh, of course I will.
It's a challenge.
Matt, slow down your roll. Don't do this.
I've already bought it. Good luck. It's going to kick you out of the car.
Any other comments from the community? Questions about land investing.
I'm trying to mail another 500 people. I'm not going to buy an $11 GoDaddy handle.
It's
with tax. Yeah, Massachusetts. What are the other questions out there in the group?
There it is. Purchased. Startwiththewin.com.
Nice.
Finalized.
I'm verifying.
Very good.
And I'm going to mock it up now to 10,000.
You know what's weird is it just went down to 299. It's like, it knows that you bought it. And it just went down to $2. How weird.
They can't
How
buy
strange
it.
Is that? I won't sell strange. It.
Startwiththewin.com. Okay.
Now, so did you buy
Let's do another US?
No.
Let's do another fun segment for the first time watches. And for the returnees, because I know they love this segment.
By the way you just said watches, what you're gonna do here.
It's time for the Boston Lega segment.
Yes. He shoots, he scores. The Laga. I love the Laga.
Matt, by the way, we went to San Tapio's when we got off the plane. We had the Lyft driver bring us in. We walked in with our suitcases today.
How was it?
Carafe of wine and pizza, and it was awesome.
It's a tough life being you, man. Look at you. Accepted offers, traveling. It's pizza. Man, when I grow up, I want to be Mike Zeno.
Oh,
Florida beaches,
nickname Forbes.
Salt Lake in Texas. Hey, you got a rough life, buddy. Anyway, this is my favorite Boston Legged Word of the Week.
The cheetah. Cheetah. Never play cards with a cheetah.
The cheetah. Never play cards with a cheetah. It's the favorite.
Cheetah.
So the Boston Legged segment of the word, segment of the week, is when I spell a word, and Mike, in his Bostonian prowess, pronounces the word.
I can't even say the word prowess.
You ready?
I'm ready.
Here's the word, Mike. S-M-A-R-T.
Oh, wicked.
Smart.
Smart.
Wicked smart.
Wicked smart.
My boy's wicked smart, yo. Smart.
Yo, he's wicked smart. How would you say that, Scott Bossman, in Wisconsin?
I would say that's smart.
Whoa, that sounds real odd if you ask me.
Sounds pretty hoity-toity.
Smart.
Smart.
You all comment in the
you know what smart
comment, please. How you would pronounce that word.
You can
type that phonetically in the comments.
You know what? You want to know what is smart?
What is smart?
Never playing cards with a cheetah.
That is smart to never play cards with a cheetah.
Wow. I literally cannot believe I stay up late at night to do this.
Oh, but you're having so much fun.
This was the largest live viewership we've ever had.
27,000 people.
It's the boot camp magic, I'm telling you.
It is. Or maybe we have Matt No Nickname Forbes on here and they like him.
I'm not the precursor to Eric Peterson. Wasn't that his way back?
Did he have no nickname?
Yeah.
Before they called him the burger, make it a double Forbes.
Matt, make it a double.
I had a nickname.
I had a guy come up to me and he's like, I know you. He's like, yeah, you're on that the nightcap thing. He's like, you're the guy who drinks all the time. And I'm like, meanwhile, I'm standing in line for the bar. So I guess you
got to argue that one, huh?
I guess so.
You're like, buy me a drink then.
Oh, that's funny stuff.
I'm like, give me your drink ticket, kid. Raw. Cooper Walker has a question.
Yeah, I see that. I just saw that. How difficult is it to purchase land with a deceased person on the deed? In Texas, it appears you can use an affidavit of heirship and bypass probate. Have you guys had luck with stuff like this?
So the affidavit of heirship in Texas can work, but from my understanding, you have to have everybody that could potentially be, this is my understanding, that could potentially be in line, sign off on it. So if you miss somebody, so I think that that is a route from what I've been told, but you know, most often I think it's a probate issue. That's the best way to go about those. So listen, you're going to come across deals that are going to basically break your heart. Like you know, your high school sweetheart did, right? It's going to break your heart. Hot. And you know, the thing is, there's just like, you know, your parents are telling you in high school, there's somebody else out there for you, right? There's another deal out there waiting for you, right? So if you got one that has a problem with probate, don't sweat it. Don't try to make a deal out of something that's not a deal, right? You know that song, creating something out of nothing at all? Well, that's not always the case with land, right? Making love out of nothing at all. What's that song?
I'm happy to report I don't know the answer.
God knows it. Look, he knows it.
Bosman's dying.
Bosman, no. You know the song.
No, I don't know that song.
Love out of nothing, I wish I did. At all. Come on, our viewers know this one.
Sing the chorus again, one more time.
Making love out of nothing at all.
Yeah, that song. I bet Nicole Capolino knows. She just tuned in. I bet she knows that
air
song.
Supply. Air supply. Making love out of nothing at all.
This is, again, Zeno's dating himself. He loves this. Okay, Matt Forbes, I'm going to ask you. When you think 80s music, what names come to mind?
80s music.
Bon Jovi, Guns N' Roses,
yep.
Aerosmith,
George Michael Leppard. George Michael.
When I say 80s music to Mike Zeno, wham. You know what comes to mind? Do you know what comes to mind for Mike Zeno?
What?
Air Supply.
Really? Really?
Air Supply.
Well, he's an interesting cat, that Mike Zeno.
He is an interesting part cat.
So it's like Air Supply and then Wham. It's like 1-2 and then
Steve Foster's an Air Supply fan. Maybe he's not. He's just saying when it was. He remembers when it was. Cindy Lauper is another good one from the 80s for sure. But 80? Air Supply.
Yeah, I'm like Aerosmith and all those guys.
Anyway.
They're Boston guys.
Are we having fun tonight, guys? This is fun. This has been fun. Mike, you look busy over there. Are you busy?
I'm getting something ready for the outro.
Oh, you're getting something ready for the outro. Okay, awesome.
You can tell, like, when he's focused. Everybody watch Mike's eyes. He, like, glazes.
Yeah, his eyes are, like, all over the place.
Yeah, and he starts, like, really focusing on making sure the podcast goes well or whatever the hell this is. Yeah, it's pretty funny.
Oh, let's do one more question for Tyler Anlicker, because he's also a pretty good, faithful viewer. If the online recorder only has deeds recorded online 1990 and after, what do you do, Mike Zano, for due diligence when there's no deeds posted?
Mike, yeah.
So I am a firm believer in making good friends with any county you're going to work in. Mm. By that I mean this county's. And you know what? It's not a scheme. It's true. I appreciate what they do. So if they were to receive some gourmet muffins and coffee, and have an appreciative note saying I appreciate all you do. That is true. And then when I call them again, they don't forget who I am, and they tend to be a lot more helpful. Additionally, there are places out there. You could hire someone off of Craigslist to go out and pull a deed for you, because those ones, you can still go to the county and actually get the deeds. You just have to have somebody pull it, right? So you could hire someone off of Craigslist. There are companies out there that may cost you upwards of $100 to go pull that deed. But you know what? If the property has enough value in it, it's worth it. So there's always a way around the problem.
Very true. Yeah, you can. And, you know, Tyler, you can hire somebody in that area off Craigslist or whatever to go to the courthouse for you and pull those.
I agree with Aaron Williams, by the way. Cindy Lauper.
What do you say? Guys
forgot about her.
I didn't forget about Cindy
Lauper. That's the 80s. Cindy Lauper.
You know what, Mike? If you're going to list the top 10 artists from the 80s, Air Supply is not in it.
It has to be in it.
It's not in it.
Top 10 80s bands. Here we go.
You too. Matt Forbes, I'm going to name them right now. I will name them right now.
Go.
Wait a minute. Is it for a bottle of whiskey? If it happens to be Air Supply, you owe me a bottle of whiskey. If it's not, I owe you a bottle.
Oh, let's each name our top 10.
No, I just want to know if Air Supply is. That's it. I only care about Air Supply.
I just want free whiskey.
Bon Jovi. Def Leppard.
Yep.
Guns N' Roses.
Yep.
Cyndi Lauper.
George Michael.
No.
Madonna. Well, why are you helping me? Michael Jackson.
You sure? Jackson.
He's not on the list? Prince? Forbes, get a legitimate source, please.
What number is Air Supply, Matt?
This is top 10s. So top10s.com. Number
what number is Air Supply?
This is how you know this is a little shady. Number one, Duran Duran.
No. Well, yes.
Number two, Queen. Three, Bon Jovi. Four, Metallica. Five, Guns N' Roses. Van Halen. Journey.
U2,
AC/DC. And finally, Motley Crue. Yeah,
exactly.
I owe you a bottle of whiskey, Scott Busman.
Poison, Motley Crue.
The Police, Tears for Fears. Poison, Iron Maiden. The Cure. In excess.
Zeno, you're killing me. Harrison was 49 on the list.
Maybe they were the 70s.
Genesis.
Yeah, they were late 70s, early 80s, but their window was short.
All right.
Short.
Well, that's right, Barbara Thibodeau. The Air Supply was the 70s. You know what? And I grew up with the radio waking me up with an alarm clock in the 70s, and I probably heard them a lot there, and that's why.
Dire Straits. I want to go play some music now.
But
yeah, right?
I think we should probably wrap it up for me.
I think we should probably wrap it up.
The most viewers. We don't want to – listen.
We don't want to scale.
This is actually a fun and informative show. Would you agree, Matt? We had a lot of topics on here. Scott, we talked about a lot of things here tonight.
It was good. Hey, look who shows up. Sonny Holbrook says, and I quote, Sonny Holbrook is here. Look at that.
You're not a person.
No, he is. We had a big, we weren't making fun of Sonny. We were making fun of Sonny. Because he just cleaned up because of the land business. And he freaking hates every second of it. And I love that man for it. Because he does not enjoy Facebook at all.
Well, Sonny, Sonny, I've shared a cocktail with you in person. I wish I was sharing one with you now virtually, because that would be a lot of fun. But please join us on Wednesday or Thursday nights. Mike, what's next week's schedule looking like?
Probably Thursday.
Well, let's do next Thursday.
Oh, Wednesday. Is that better, Matt?
I'm traveling for my real job in the beginning and the end of the week. So I could do Wednesday. I can't do Thursday, but
we're going to shoot for Wednesday. Unless it's a game changing moment, we're going to shoot for Wednesday.
Okay.
Scott. Wednesday, 10:30 Eastern.
Followed by go to 10:30 to 11:30, followed by a 6 a.m. flight to Denver.
All right. Fine.
Ouch.
I'm going to put a drink because, Scott, you're going to come up with some kind of cool toast, right?
Yeah, you know, I've been thinking about it.
All right, let's hear it.
Actually, have been thinking about it. But
Boston, Pet Shop Boys, Pink Floyd.
You know, Huey Lewis
in the news? I'm on number 86.
Oh, I love Huey Lewis in the news.
I do. You know, it's funny. I do, too. I have a huge music buddy, too, who I, like, went to his house. He's like, dude, we'll play your songs. And I'm like, yeah, we'll put on this thing. And Huey Lewis in the news came on. And he literally walked up, and he took the speaker, and he knocked it off the deck. I was like, I hate Huey Lewis in the news.
No, Huey Lewis.
Who are you?
He had two albums in the 80s that I loved, Sports and Four. They were amazing.
Yeah.
So anyway.
You can't sing anymore. Okay, keep going.
Nicole Capolino, why are you dying? I want to know why she's dying.
She's laughing. That means she's happy.
Well, Sonny Holbrook is her, I don't want to call him father-in-law, but it's close to that.
Probably because Sonny's talking about himself in the third person. She probably thinks that's funny.
Yes.
Anyway,
probably yelling at us right now, I think, is the deal.
He's probably talking to us.
By the way, we have a bet going with Nicole, right?
So Nicole, what's that?
Verify the bet here. I was challenged. We were drinking in the airport. Patriots versus Kansas City. Loser buys the winner a lot somewhere in America. Any lot. Ah. Anywhere. Gonna buy land. So
you shook on it?
You want a piece of that, just go ahead and type it into the chat there and we'll call that a deal.
Whoa, you shook on it?
We didn't shake on it. We were just sort of dancing around it. Chiefs. Tyler, Chiefs? Come on, Nicole. It's in. It's on. Loser buys a lot. I love it. It's way more fun than the
do this.
All right. So here, I don't have a fancy toast tonight, but I want to toast to you clowns, and I want to toast to community, because the community, the Land Geek community has given me so much. It's really difficult to put into words. Friends, knowledge, and people that raise the glass ceiling that make me better. So here's the community with the Land Geeks.
Community.
Cheers.
Yes.
There he is. Love it.
Cheers. You guys ready to do the outro?
I am.
I'm ready.
In honor of Scott Bossman. Everybody, glad to have you here. I know I want to rule something, I know how to break it. And I'll never let you fall. And I don't know how you do it. They're not even in the top 100. Not even in the top 100. Out of nothing at all. Out of nothing at all. Out of nothing at all.